swept away by their love affair. When Sharon Stone wants revenge, she hires Sylvester Stallone, the specialist. And Dan Aykroyd and Rosie O'Donnell go undercovers at Dana Delaney's Fantasy Resort in Exit to Eden.
He'd say, let me get this straight. You're hung up on some guy because you two cruised around Gilligan's Island in Valley High for 3 days. Isn't that a little nutty?
Yeah, Warren Beatty and Annette Bening are in love in Love Affair, which is one of six new movies we'll review this week on Siskel and Ebert. Also coming up, Sylvester Stallone's new thriller, Freddy Krueger's new nightmare, Dana Delaney as a dominatrix, and Hoop Dreams, the most remarkable documentary of the year. I'm Roger Ebert of the Chicago Sun-Times.
And I'm Gene Siskel of the Chicago Tribune. Our first film is Love Affair, the remake of An Affair to Remember with Warren Beatty and Annette Bening in the Cary Grant and Deborah Kerr roles of lovers who almost never find each other after their first flush of romance. Warren Beatty plays a womanizing former football star who is mesmerized by Annette Bening while on a trip to Australia. One problem? They're both engaged to marry someone else.
You don't play around, do you?
No, but I think I might have to if I were involved with someone like you.
Ah, but you wouldn't, because you're way too fussy.
Fussy?
Cautious. Playing around is like this stuff. Too much of it's bad for you, but a little raises the HDLs.
HDLs?
Good for the heart.
Is it?
During a stop in Tahiti, Beatty takes Bening to meet his wise old aunt, played by Katharine Hepburn. Again, real life creates excitement as Beatty lured Hepburn out of retirement for this part in which, late in the film, she will literally pass her mantle on to Bening.
These petals are supposedly the hands of a Polynesian princess. It's been hanging around for 62 years and is still holding together. I wish I could say the same for myself.
The linchpin of the Affair to Remember story, which was also used in The Inferior, Sleepless in Seattle, is that the two lovers agree to meet atop the Empire State Building after 3 months if they decide to dump their fiancés for each other.
I mean, the point is, if you really want to...
Take a chance.
Yeah. Take a chance on this guy. Make him get his life in order.
During this period of reflection, Beatty talks about romance with his agent, Gary Shandling, playing the sort of venal, shallow nerd he does so well.
What is the deal with you? What do you mean, what's the deal? I want to simplify my life. Is that so hard to understand? Well, I understand it when it comes to my life, but this is your life. You have a great life. I love your life.
Ultimately, Love Affair stands or falls on the chemistry of Beatty and Bening. Obviously, they have it in real life. And on the screen, they have it too. Because Bening's character so often seems a step ahead of Beatty's. This is a sweet, small story, and the revelation for me is not just how great it is to see Hepburn again, but just how good of an actress Annette Bening is. She's bright and beguiling, as her character must be for this love affair to work.
One of the interesting things about the construction of this story is that the scene in which the tide turns and the two people basically become destined for each other,
right,
takes place without the two people on the screen. It takes place between Annette Bening and Katharine Hepburn.
Yes.
And Hepburn is the catalyst that changes what happened before between this couple to what's going to happen after. And that's very interesting because it shows a kind of a magic descending from the skies in the form of Hepburn to bless this couple.
The other thing is, I guess I'm repeating myself, but Bening to me was the real revelation here. She's been very good in The Grifter. She's a strong character. Mm-hmm. I think her playing here is really exciting.
Well, I wasn't as surprised as you were because I've admired her right along, and she's been in one good movie after another. What she has is a kind of a crisp alertness, awareness on the screen of what's happening that makes everybody around here kind of perk up a little
bit. And you see it in nonverbal situations when they first meet, and she's playing him a little bit. He's smart, but she's playing him a little smarter. It works very well.
She's kind of amused with him at times. Yeah, okay, next movie, and it's something unusual. A horror movie within a horror movie. It's called Wes Craven's New Nightmare, and it begins where the Nightmare on Elm Street series left off. You may recall, or maybe you don't, that in the sixth installment of the popular series, Freddy Krueger, the monster with the knives for fingers, was finally killed for once and all. Unfortunately, it now appears that the series generated an evil force which has been liberated by the screenplay for a sequel and is now haunting the lives of the people who made the films. Many of the stars and filmmakers play themselves, including actress Heather Langenkamp, who played a teenager in the original 1984 movie. Now her life and child are being threatened by ominous omens.
There was no movie. There was only her life.
It's just me.
Maybe the only way to stop the nightmares is to make another film and exorcise them forever. Bob Shea, the head of New Line Cinema, plays himself here, trying to sell the idea to the actress.
The fans, you know, the fans, God bless them, they're clamoring for more. I guess evil never dies, right? Anyhow, a few weeks ago, I got a call from Wes, and he pitched me this really exciting idea. And I started thinking, who better to resurrect Freddy than his creator?
And veteran thriller maker Wes Craven, who directed that original film, thinks he knows how the supernatural is linked to the cinematic.
Who I mean?
Well, dramatically speaking, it makes perfect sense. You played Nancy, after all, and you were the first to humiliate him, defeat him.
That was Nancy, Wes. It's not me.
Yeah, but it was you that gave Nancy her strength. So in order to get out, he's got to come through you. And it's inevitable that he's going to try to do that at your most vulnerable points.
Wes Craven's New Nightmare is the first horror movie that is actually about the frequently asked question, don't the people who make these films ever ask themselves about the effect the films have? It's very intriguing the way the film dances back and forth across the line between fantasy and reality. On the one hand, it's in the Nightmare on Elm Street tradition with frightening dream sequences using scary special effects. And on the other hand, it's a look behind the scenes of Hollywood. It's smart, it's scary, and it's curiously thought-provoking.
It didn't provoke a single thought in my head.
No.
Roger, they put in these people who you and I know, and so it's kind of campy fun to see them in their real-life roles on the screen. But at the core level, this is a mad slasher movie with Freddy, who I have never enjoyed as a villain, and I don't enjoy him here. It's just the same old bloodletting with new
actors
around.
It's too bad that the movie didn't provoke a couple of more thoughts in your head. For example, the use of that little child in some of the sequences, such as when he's up on top of that tower, is very scary and I think very effective. The whole way that the idea, it's kind of a dangerous idea that people who are actors in these movies might have their own lives affected by the nightmares that they are creating for others.
But it's
never been done before.
But Roger, no, what I'm saying is it's so obvious and it isn't really dealt with. I don't feel that they're really in jeopardy. It's just an excuse to have the same old bloodletting.
Coming up next, I do not agree.
Well, we don't. Good. Coming up next, two undercover cops infiltrate a resort known for its wild sexual fantasies in Anne Rice's Exit to Eden.
It's like Elvis goes to hell.
Mistress Lisa.
Do your parents know you do this?
Dana Delaney is the mistress in charge of a kinky vacation spot in Exit to Eden, a thoroughly goofy mess, the kind of sex comedy that needs to be a whole lot sexier or a whole lot funnier to work. When a picture like this misses, it can be pretty embarrassing. Exit to Eden is set on a resort island where the big fantasy is master-slave relationships, with Dana Delaney improbably cast as the dominatrix and Paul Mercurio as one of the visiting slaves who will presumably be liberated by his sexual vacation there.
I don't even know your last name. Tell me.
You have to go along with the illusion, Elliot, or else it doesn't work. Now bathe me.
Even worse, and I mean really worse, is a slapstick subplot involving Rosie O'Donnell and Dan Aykroyd as a couple of detectives trailing Mercurio, a witness to a drug deal.
Whoa. Well, pardon me, moi.
She's trying to kill me, you idiot! Shut up! Come on! Cuffer!
I don't have any cuffs.
We're the only two people on this island without handcuffs.
Exit to Eden is so bad, I almost have to admire the guts of the people who made it. You know that fine film out now about Ed Wood, the bad movie director? Well, this might be the kind of goofy picture he'd make today, only to have it laughed off the screen, which is pretty much how I felt about Exit to Eden.
I felt the same way. It was directed by Gary Marshall, who's made some good pictures of Pretty Woman, Flamingo Kid. This movie is a total disaster from beginning to end. And one of the things they don't understand is that kinky sex is funny only when it's taken seriously. When you have this kind of dress-up charade here with these people on this island, and where did they get those tourists? All the guys look like Chippendales dancers.
Right.
All the girls look like mud wrestlers.
Right.
And
the costumes also. Yeah, so it's done out of a 50s or early 60s costuming
mentality. Yeah.
I mean,
as for Rosie O'Donnell, she seemed to be mad. She wasn't funny.
Not at all.
The plot was totally unnecessary.
Aykroyd is wasted.
The plot is completely unnecessary that they're in.
Right.
And then every time she was on the screen, she gave me negative feelings.
I've been getting negative feelings from her in movies for a long time. When we come back, the new documentary everybody in the film world seems to be talking about, Hoop Dreams, is next.
Derek Zimmerman's layup pushes Marshall to a one-point lead. Moments later, a Westinghouse foul, and then a double technical puts Arthur on the line with a chance to ice the victory.
That's a young man named Arthur Agee there at a key moment in a key game in his senior year in high school in a wonderful new documentary named Hoop Dreams. And you may remember that we first talked about this movie way last January on this show. We saw a special preview here in Chicago before it went on to conquer every film festival, Sundance, Toronto, New York. And we reviewed it early because we wanted to say how good it was, call attention to it.
The reason we wanted to call attention to it is we were hoping it would get a theatrical release, which it is now getting nationwide.
And that's what it deserves. This is an extraordinary film that covers 6 years in the lives of two talented inner city kids from grade school to the first year in college as they dream of someday becoming basketball stars. As the movie opens, Arthur is being recruited by a Chicago suburban basketball powerhouse, St. Joseph High School.
I can't promise you where you're going to go and if you're going to be a star, but I guarantee that I would help you get into the school that would be best for you.
Arthur knows he's following in the steps of another inner-city Chicago kid, Isaiah Thomas, who also went to St. Joseph's and went on to become a legend in the pros.
In everybody's neighborhood, there's a guy who can really play. He shoots the lights out every time down court. Then he goes to St. Joseph High School, and the guy gets cut. Say, Thomas, real good. Why did he get cut? See, Tom didn't learn the fundamentals of team basketball, which is what you're learning how to play.
The other subject of the film is another talented young man, William Gates, who is also recruited by St. Joseph's. He gets lots of offers when he becomes a high school All-American.
Any school you name.
I'm
Dear William, there's gold at the end of the rainbow.
Hoop Dreams is one of those rare film experiences where you simply forget yourself and sit there totally involved in the incredible drama of what's happening. You may think you don't want to see a film about the inner city or about basketball, or you don't want to see a 3-hour documentary about anything. But please forget those preconceptions. Hoop Dreams is a great film, and you owe it to yourself to see it.
Oh, I think it's wonderful, as we've talked about earlier this year. And what I love is, and we must remember, the filmmakers who had this idea. And I love when filmmakers have the courage to say, you know what, we're going to spend a whole bunch of time tracking people's lives.
Mm-hmm.
Here we're following kids for 6 years, and of course their lives are full of drama.
What's remarkable, they started out to make a 30-minute documentary about these eighth graders, and they realized, no, we're stuck with these guys for the long run, and they made 250 hours of film about these two kids, and the result of that is they have all of these incredibly dramatic moments, and there are twists in this story that if they were in a fiction film, you'd say, that's too incredible. It's an exhilarating experience.
And the bottom line is that when I saw this picture, and we take them up to college, first year.
Yes, we do.
I had one thought, and people are going to have the same thought. I wonder how they're playing now. I wonder what they're doing now.
And you know what I found out? They're both still in college.
When we come back, Sharon Stone is looking for the specialist who can avenge her parents' murder, and Sylvester Stallone gets the job.
The only thing I understand anymore is revenge.
You'll only get one of them.
That's why I need you.
Then it's just awful, thanks to endless explosions and a truly bad, truly stiff performance by Sylvester Stallone playing a former CIA explosives expert hired by Sharon Stone to rub out mobsters who killed her parents when she was a little girl. Stallone's voice is so solemn here, it's laughable.
Don't contact me. I'll contact you.
Maybe I can help you. Let me see it.
No. They're my problem now, and I'm theirs.
The explosion scenes in The Specialist seem tired because this is the third Mad Bomber movie we've seen in the last few months, following Speed and Blown Away. Of course, the real fireworks that people want to see are the sex scenes between Stallone and Stone. And we do catch them naked in a shower for about a minute as they show their great bodies. At other times, we get silly sexual posturing between them. The one bright spot in the film, the always entertaining James Woods, here trading insults with old adversary Stallone. Watch and listen to Woods act the stolid Stallone right off the screen.
You killed an innocent bystander, Ray, and it's just eating you up inside, isn't it? But guess what? I'm coming, Ray. I'm coming to take all the pain away.
By the way, that 1 minute of nudity really isn't worth sitting through the dreadfully dull action of The Specialist. During the whole picture, I wanted Stallone to talk faster and drop his Rambo persona in favor of something contemporary. You know, maybe he and James Woods sort of switched roles. I wonder what James Woods looked like in the shower.
I don't, frankly, but
you know how I mean that.
You're right about Stallone. He was a lot more entertaining than Cliffhanger, but here it's a thankless role, and furthermore, it's a thankless movie. Now, I don't want to give anything away.
Oh, you always scare me.
Heaven forbid. But there was a character in this movie that wants to kill X people for one reason and Y people for another reason, and it's utterly unconvincing, and it leads to some dead ends in the plot and some loose strings, and you begin to ask yourself questions about motivation, and it's completely ridiculous. And then you get these dumb explosions, and you forgot True Lies, which is another bomb movie that was so much better that the special effects in here are really tawdry by comparison. Coming up next, Rick Moranis and Ed O'Neill coach competing peewee football teams in Little Giants.
Century Plaza, offering the finest in luxury service in Southern California style, adjacent to Beverly Hills on LA's fashionable west side. The Century Plaza Hotel and Tower.
Our next movie is named Little Giants, and this is a creatively bankrupt retread of about six other recent movies on the same subject. Now see if this plot sounds familiar. A team of kids who are losers and wimps practice real hard and dare to dream that they might be able to defeat another team made up of kids who are arrogant jocks. Real original. Rick Moranis plays the younger brother of Heisman Trophy winner Ed O'Neill, and since they've been kids, O'Neill has always been the jock, and Moranis has always been the loser on the field and in love.
Danny?
Hi.
Danny O'Shea, how are you?
Fine. Really good.
Well, come on in.
Sure.
When O'Neill doesn't pick Moranis' daughter for his Pop Warner team, Moranis gets mad and recruits a team of all the local rejects.
I'm just going to get the diagram.
Coach, they're going to do the super secret play.
State police? Oh, thank God. This is Thelma Mae Rogers. I'm 86 years old. I live in Urbana. There are two men down the bridge from the Shell station in the bushes spying on some kids.
Please hurry.
Oh. Nice going.
Yeah.
Little Giants uses the same formula as the Mighty Ducks, the Sandlot, Bad News Bears, and the same formula that was used in grown-up sports pictures like Cool Runnings and Major League. It's so hard to make a movie that I wonder why anybody would even bother with something as unnecessary as this one.
It is unnecessary, and I suppose maybe our criticism is unnecessary, but we just want to warn people off from taking their kids and wasting their money. There's so many other good films around.
Okay, let's take another look at the movies we reviewed this week. Two thumbs up for Love Affair, the sometimes corny but sweet and moving remake of two Hollywood classics. The movie stars Warren Beatty and Annette Bening and will be opening in theaters next week. A split vote on Wes Craven's New Nightmare. I thought the film within a film device was effective and entertaining. Gene thought it was a cover story for a slasher plot. Two thumbs down, way down for Exit to Eden, a movie that fails in every possible way to be sexy, funny, smart, or entertaining. Two very enthusiastic thumbs up for Hoop Dreams, the extraordinary documentary about two high school kids who dream of changing their lives through their basketball skills. This is one of the year's very best films. But two thumbs down for The Specialist, with one of the more misguided screenplays of the year making for badly confused motives. And finally, two more thumbs down for Little Giants, the comedy about Pee-wee football that is just another retread of the tired sports underdog formula. And so the real discovery is Hoop Dreams.
Absolutely. Love Affair is a good picture, but Hoop Dreams is great. That's it for this week. Next week, we'll be back with reviews of more new movies, including two comedies. Woody Allen's Bullets Over Broadway, starring John Cusack as a budding playwright stuck with an eccentric cast, and Radioland Murders, starring Mary Stuart Masterson in a story by George Lucas. It's about a radio station where the body count is bigger than the ratings. That's next week, and until then, the balcony is closed.